What a difference a couple of weeks make in the always tough SEC. Ole Miss could be tied for first in the SEC West, except for a loss 2 weeks ago to Arkansas in an NCAA record 7 overtimes. Fast forward to last weekend, when the Rebels were probably cheering for today's opponent, Georgia, to knock off West Division leader Auburn. The Bulldogs had visions of the miracle of Tennessee dancing in their heads as they mounted up for a final drive against the Tigers, only to be stopped short of forcing a possible overtime. But that's behind them today. Eli Manning and Ole Miss will try to take a bite of David Green and the 23rd-ranked Georgia Bulldogs in a huge SEC East-West clash. It's live from Oxford, next. It's a family affair in Oxford. Eli Manning getting a hug and a kiss from his mother and his father Archie on his way to Vaught-Hemingway Stadium, where David Cutcliffe and Mark Richt, two brilliant offensive minds, will match wits today in an SEC East versus West matchup. It's the Bulldogs and the Rebels. It's our Jefferson Pilot Game of the Week. And hello again, everybody. I'm Dave Neal. Thanks for joining us. A glorious day at the Grove for some college football. Glad you could be with us. The Auburn Tigers are a team that are out front right now of the SEC Western Division. The Ole Miss Rebels certainly need a win today to keep pace, but they would also like to see Alabama step up later this afternoon in the Iron Bowl and knock off the Auburn Tigers to give Ole Miss a chance to make it to the SEC title game on December 8th. But Auburn certainly has to lose, and Ole Miss has to win. And my partner, who always wins, is with me right now, Dave Rowe. And Dave, when we begin to look at this football game, two things come to mind.
Yeah.
Quarterbacks.
Amen, brother. Amen.
Eli Manning has had a great season, and certainly I think he surpassed maybe many people's expectations. But what about yours?
Well, I think right now Eli Manning is just, he's an incredible quarterback. He's got great anticipation. That's a term that you don't hear a lot of times with quarterback. He anticipates when he's going to get, when the receivers are going to get open. He's got a great understanding of the skills of the game. And I'll tell you this. He is unbelievably, as far as laid back, he is amazing. I've never seen anybody more laid back.
There might be one guy.
Oh, who?
He's the quarterback for the other team, David Green, yeah. The redshirt freshman, the left-hander, Dave. He has come in about his business and has been almost as successful as Eli Manning.
Oh, I love this kid. He's the same mold as an Eli Manning. David Green's got great vision downfield. He's got great leadership and confidence. They just think he is just a marvelous football player.
A lot of times we'll focus in on the running backs or the quarterbacks to get a game set up, but you went a little deeper and you found a matchup on the field today that you think will be in the trenches that should be something fans should keep an eye on.
Oh, it's one of the great matches, fans, that you're going to love to watch. It's a matchup between Charles Grant. He's around the corner. What a game he get against Auburn. He's got speed to get around the corner. If you set too deep on him, he comes up underneath. He's got a great motor and 4 sacks against Auburn. That was just fantastic. But he's going to match up today against Terrence Metcalf. And this young man, this is a football player, number 79, hasn't allowed a sack since 1999. Great work ethics, great skills, balance, everything that you want. And he had a drive block in Alabama that'll make every highlight film.
Here come the Ole Miss Rebels. They have lost 4 straight games to the Georgia Bulldogs. They hope to break that string this afternoon. It's our JP Game of the Week. Georgia, Ole Miss, coming your way next. 5-3 Georgia, 6-2 Ole Miss. Our Game of the Week on Jefferson Pilot. Let's go down to the sideline. Scott Przewanski is our sideline reporter, and he's standing alongside Georgia head coach Mark Richt.
Coach, every battle in the SEC every week is always so tough. What do you expect out of Ole Miss this afternoon?
Well, it's going to be a great game, but I wanted to say hello to David Jacobs and his family at Emory Hospital today. I want you to know our prayers and our thoughts are with you, David, and your family, and these players are going to play for David Jacobs today.
Okay, Coach, I know they'll come out tough. That's Coach Mark Richt. He knows his Bulldogs are ready for the Rebels, Dave.
Thank you very much, Scott. You'll be with us throughout the afternoon, but to follow that up, tough break for Georgia, and we certainly send out our best, too, to David Jacobs, a defensive tackle for the Georgia Bulldogs, who suffered some neurological problems during the course of the week. He was tested in Athens. They sent him to Emory University, and he is seems to be improving. They don't know the ultimate end result of what his problems are neurologically speaking, if I can get that out. So hopefully he will be okay, and certainly we're thinking about him as well.
And Dave, one person that they didn't think they could lose, of course, was David.
Coach Cutcliffe, 22-11 in his tenure at Ole Miss. Very excited about the way this program is heading. Why not? Ole Miss will receive the football. Armstead, Jason Armstead, will take a knee in the end zone. The Rebels will take over at the 20-yard line. And the man to run the show, Eli Manning. Eli Manning has been awesome this season. Eli Manning has put up a touchdown to interception ratio that no one in the country has surpassed this year. 23 TDs, 2 interceptions. And he is calm, cool, and collected. 6'4", 215 pounds out of New Orleans, Louisiana. Known for over 2,200 yards. Stackhouse in motion on first and 10. The opening offensive play falls incomplete. Intended receiver was Armstead. Bruce Thornton on the coverage. Here's our Chevy starting lineup for the Ole Miss Rebels. Doug Ziegler, the tight end, has the last few weeks been exceptional for the Rebels. Of course, he is the roommate of Eli Manning. The offensive line led by Terrence Metcalf. German Bello gets a start at one of the guard spots for Doug Buckles today. We'll keep an eye on German in that offensive front that's allowed only 8 sacks this season. Make that 9. Charles Grant, who had 4 sacks last week against Auburn, continues his assault on quarterbacks, and he picks up a sack to bring up 3rd down.
Yeah, he's on the left of your screen. Top, he's against Belton Johnson. Just comes underneath, just explodes back in there. Doesn't give Manning any time to look downfield and get rid of the football. So Charles Grant just keeps it coming.
Grant, 6'4", 265 pounds. Loss of 8, 3rd down and 18 now for the Rebels. Jermaine Phillips on a safety blitz. Phillips in on the tackle as well as William Witherspoon. Joe Gunn lost a couple of yards, and Ole Miss will have to punt it away early on. Georgia's defense looks like this. There's Charles Grant. Good thing we highlighted him. Linebackers, Gilbert, Bailey, Witherspoon. A little banged up, but good linebackers. And Jermaine Phillips and Wansley, two guys in the secondary who have been very consistent all season long. Ole Miss will punt it away on 4th and 21. Cody Ridgeway, short punt, hits at the 38, but bounces right at the midfield stripe, and that is where Georgia will take over. A 41-yard punt, it was ugly, and Georgia has great field position to start for that man, David Green, the redshirt freshman out of Lithonia, Georgia. He, too, has had a brilliant opening campaign. He has completed 61% of his passes, 4th best at Georgia. Green also 13 touchdowns, 6 interceptions. He will open up in a shotgun formation. Opening handoff goes to Veron Haynes. Anthony Sims on the tackle. Here's the Georgia lineup that has had some shakeups over the last couple of weeks. Terrence Edwards back in the starting lineup at a wide receiver. JT Wall will start at the fullback spot today. That is because Veron Haynes gets the start at tailback. He's normally the fullback. That's because Moussa Smith still bothered by a groin injury. The offensive line led by John Stinchcomb, who is one of the best in America. Here's Haynes. He falls forward to about the 46-yard line. Tackle made by Rob Robertson. Here's our Chevy Ole Miss defensive lineup. Anthony Sims leads the team with 6 tackles for loss. He had 11 tackles versus Arkansas. There were 5 Ole Miss players that finished with double-digit tackles in that 7 overtime loss to the Razorbacks 2 weeks ago. Von Hutchins, another guy who's had 3 consecutive games with double-digit tackles. It is 3rd down and 5. Green rolls to the far side. His pass off the hands of the freshman receiver, Fred Gibson. And Georgia
will have to punt it away in their opening possession as well.
Yeah, back-to-back three and outs. That's not what you want. When you get great field position, as Georgia did at midfield, you've got to move the chains. You've got to get some continuity on offense. They're going to give the football right back to Ole Miss. Ole Miss is going to have a better position than they had last time. So each one has kind of miscued to start this game, Dave.
Georgia had five or six three and outs last week against Auburn, which was a season high for them, and they tried to avoid that. That was kind of a goal today. Didn't happen on the opening possession.
Start right off with three and out.
Throw goes punt. Oh, taken by Armstead at the five. That was a line drive that would have certainly gone into the end zone. So Ole Miss backed up. It will start from the five. Scoreless in Oxford, Mississippi. First quarter action. Ole Miss takes over for the second time today. Their first drive went three plays. They lost 11 yards. So Eli Manning under center in the I formation. Zipper is tied in motion. Off goes to Joe Gunn. He picks up three and a half, close to the 10-yard line.
Joe Gunn is the ball carrier to the lane.
And tackle made by Boss Bailey. Boss has been one of the healthier linebackers at Georgia this year. Boss counterparts, Will Witherspoon, Tony Gilbert, have both been hammered pretty heavily with injuries. Will Witherspoon had a knee sprain, missed a couple of games. Tony Gilbert suffered a concussion earlier this year. Tries to bounce it to the outside, but Charles Grant, what has happened to Charles Grant in the last 2 weeks, Dave?
Hello, Charles Grant. He's just all over the field. Got that great pass rushing sack early in the game. This time plays the outside, keeps that containment, just slides along the line. Right of your screen, you're going to see him just slide, keep outside position. When he pops out there, he brings him down for a loss. You're right, Dave. He is playing stellar football.
There are his numbers from last week. Career game. Five tackles for loss, four sacks. He also forced a fumble. Previous high for tackles was nine. He already has two here today. It is third down and 10, and flags fly.
Penalty markers on the play.
I have no idea what that was. The clock wasn't down.
Dead ball foul. False start against the offense. Movement in the offensive line. Half the distance to the goal. Still third down.
Rogers Redding, our referee today. And that'll bring up third and 13 for Ole Miss, and that four wide receiver package once again. But the good news for Eli Manning is he has four quality receivers to throw it to.
And you know Georgia's going to bring heat.
Manning a little rushed on the pass, incomplete, looking for Jason Armstead, and Ole Miss will have to punt it out of their own end zone.
Yeah, Georgia should get great field position again. And I can tell you on the sideline, the coaches on Georgia said, hey, we're not going three and out again. We've got to move those chains, get some first downs. Now, if you're Ole Miss, you want a screamer here. Get it up in the jet stream. Get as far as you can. Get it high. Don't allow any return.
Well, Georgia once again will have excellent field position. Ole Miss. Stackhouse late getting on the football field.
Oh, and the clock ran out. Oh.
Delay a game will back him up. Ole Miss has run six plays, offensively speaking, and has lost 14 yards, and you can add a couple more, or at least another yard and a half.
Timeout,
anyway.
Mississippi.
Oh, they got
first
a timeout
out of the first half.
Eli Manning trying to figure out who's going to block 19.
Yeah, exactly.
You mentioned it in the open, Dave, Terrence Metcalf, although Grant flip-flop sides on his last defensive stop.
Yeah, he was against Belton Johnson on the last two or three plays. He won't do that against Terrence Metcalf. It won't be that easy, but Grant, they've got to keep him out of the backfield. But when you get in a situation like this, Dave, you're backed up. You normally set 15 yards back off the punt. They're going to be about 11 yards off the line of scrimmage.
Minus 14 total yards for Ole Miss. Ole Miss came in scoring 38.8 points per game, second in the SEC, seventh nationally. Total offense, they were fourth in the Southeastern Conference, 433 yards. So anytime you see a negative number by Ole Miss, whether it's in the first quarter, second quarter, or third quarter, it is a huge, huge shock offensively speaking.
Oh, and if you're a punter, Dave, you really got to be careful here because you're right on the back of the end zone. If you step back 1 foot, you're out of bounds. That's a safety.
Cody Ridgeway backed up. It's a high punt. Damian Gary fields it at the 43-yard line. Gary brought down at the 30. Nice tackle by Ridgeway, the punter. Possibly saved a big game, maybe even a touchdown. Punt of 40, a return of 12. So Georgia inside the Ole Miss 30-yard line for their second possession. Their first possession went three plays, and they only amounted 4 yards.
Yeah, when you get field position, and coaches will tell you that's what this game is all about. Georgia has had the first opportunity. They did nothing with it. They have got to do something with this series.
Haynes nearly breaks it. He takes it down to the 23-yard line. Baron Haynes, of course, probably best known for the play at Tennessee. A touchdown catch to beat the Volunteers.
Absolutely. And you know what I like about Haynes is I like when they get big man on big man. He finds that little seam, and he bursts through. He has really played well. Over 4.5 yards a carry. That's a great average.
Haynes had 6 carries for 14 yards versus Auburn, but coaches say he's their best all-around back.
Oh.
And he picks up the first down on a second effort. Brought down by L.P. Spence, but not before Haynes will move the chains.
Dave, he got hit on about the 21-yard line. Watch this. He's going to cut back right in here. He's hit, right? Look at this. Just keeps those legs broad, grinding and churning, and picks up that first down. That's moving the chains. Don't look for Georgia to do anything different. Come right back out. You got something working. You've just run 3 plays, picked up a first down. You just keep on going back at it.
Flag down. Haynes inside the 15.
Now, most times when that flag's thrown at that position, you're thinking somebody lined up in the neutral zone. I didn't see any movement on Georgia.
Ole Miss, least penalized team in the Southeastern Conference, only 40 yards per game in penalties.
Well, that's certainly a trait of David Cutcliffe, as you see him there. I'll tell you one thing, when he speaks, those kids listen, don't they?
Yeah.
We have offside against the defensive player in the neutral zone at the snap. 5-yard penalty, replay, first down.
One guy who didn't listen was his defensive end, Josh Cooper, who broke some mandatory team policies this week. And Coach Cutcliffe, the starting defensive end, says, sorry, son, I don't ask for much, but.
I ask you to follow the rules.
Yeah. Haynes, touchdown, Georgia.
Ron Haynes, a 4-yard touchdown run for Georgia.
His fourth rushing touchdown. And Georgia leads it 6-0. A 12-yard scamper by Baron Haynes, the senior out of New York.
Boy, that was really an interesting run by him. What he did is he just kind of waited, hesitated just a second, let it open up, and it just spread right out in front of him.
Point after, up and good by Billy Bennett. And Georgia leads it 7-0. 9:03 to go in the first quarter. We will return to Oxford, Mississippi after a word from your local stations.
Dave, a couple of really great blocks right here. Big block up front there. Jackson gets his block. The back comes. He cuts this way, and he makes a tremendous cut back against the grain. Watch this. Little push in there now. Come off right in there. There's the lock up right there. He makes the cut back against the grain, and he's in the end zone virtually untouched.
3 plays, 28 yards. It took up 1 minute, 21 seconds. Kerouac kicks off. And Ole Miss will take a knee and bring it out to the 20-yard line and open up with their third possession of the game. And the first two, not very good. There's the Georgia scoring drive, capped off by Veron Haynes, fourth touchdown rushing of the season. Let's go down to the sidelines and check in with Scott Przewanski, who has more.
Guys, Ron Haynes is a great story. Remember, he was suspended for the first game of the season for disorderly conduct. He has come back to turn his life around and his life on the field, too. He is a playmaker and is doing a job for the Bulldogs. They love him this year so far.
Coach's rage got about him as just an all-around tremendous back. And here's another good one, stringing it to the outside. Joe Gunn nearly lost about 10 yards. Robert Williams on the carry.
But what a good penetration. Charles Grant, 19, look at him getting back there. Forces him about 5-6 yards in the backfield. Grant is just exploding off the football.
Yeah, Williams did it all he could not to lose 10, 12 yards on the carry. Charles Grant is a guy that's just so focused the last 2 weeks. It's not that he was not playing with passion and intensity, but good things really weren't happening to him, but those good things are catching up to him today and last week. Manning throws to the near side as his receiver Flowers, and he is stuck right there at the 22-yard line, a gain of only 2.
Well, a little pump fake that time by Eli Manning. I thought he was going to go deep down the sideline as he drops back. See, watch that big pump fake there. Now he goes out to the flat trying to run him deep. But Georgia reacting quickly to the football. I think Eli Manning's got to go more over the middle. He's got to find that tight end. Ziegler coming off the line, maybe curling at 12, 15 yards, but the flats are not open right now.
Third down, 9.5 for the Rebels. Manning over the middle. Pass is, well, we haven't seen a ruling. They're going to say it's a catch. At the 30, the two officials came rushing in, and Armstrong will get credit for the reception. Vieira on the coverage, and that about 2 inches good enough for a first down.
Boy, it's a good throw right at the ground. Picked this up. You see it's clearly caught off the ground. Got the hands underneath it.
Ole Miss out of trouble. Their first two drives barely got outside the 20. There's a handoff to Gunn. He's to the 36 and stopped there by Tony Gilbert. Gain of 6.
And you know, Dave, Joe Gunn has really come into his own recently. You know, like that play, that was going to design to go outside. He had a chance to bounce it. He saw that little seam back inside and just explodes. He runs with a lot more confidence, starting to get that average up, getting a lot of yards, getting a lot of carries. You really need him to play well today.
Spread formation, Manning under center. That was intended for Robert Williams, the junior from Gadsden, Alabama. I don't think Williams expected it.
Well, he's looking back into the sun if that's any kind of a defense. But I wonder, the ball just hit him right square in the face mask. You can see him as he turns around. Good night. Got to catch those.
Another third down for Ole Miss. The Rebels have been excellent on third downs this season. They've struggled here today, but overall, 48%, which is the second best rate in the Southeastern Conference. They are 1-for-3 today. And he dumps it off over the middle. That's to Sanford, the fullback, and he moves the chains because he's at the Ole Miss 45, a gain of 9.
You know, if you want to play running back for Ole Miss, you've got to be able to catch the football, and that's what Sanford does. He's a safety valve, just curls out of the backfield. As Manning looks downfield, he finds Sanford just off the line of scrimmage, just a few yards, turns around, picks up the first down, and they keep the chains moving.
Omar Rayford in motion. I formation. Play fake to Gunn. Manning to fire. Pass nearly picked off, but a flag is thrown. Bill Flowers was the intended receiver at the Georgia 45. Brandon Williams was on the coverage, and I'd like to get one more look at that. Williams certainly would like to see it, but he won't be able to.
Yeah, this is Cumber underneath.
I wonder if, oh, he did. He had his hands on him. That's exactly what he did. Brandon Williams grabbed him when he made the underneath cut. Watch right here. He comes back underneath. He has a chance to intercept that ball, but he interfered before that. Yeah, there's the hole right there. That's it.
Yeah, if you look at the tail end of the play, it looks like good coverage.
Yeah, right in here. That's great coverage.
Yeah. So big number 27 will be penalized. And another first down for the Rebels. Ryan Van Gorder, the defensive coordinator for the Bulldogs. His defense has given up a lot of yards this year, but they've been pretty good about keeping teams out of the end zone. Pass is dropped at the 10-yard line by Jason Armstead. Wansley on the coverage. It hit Armstead right in the hands.
I think Wansley played this as well as you can play it. As the ball's coming out, it's going to hit, as you said, right in the hands. But watch Wansley get that hand and rake it down. Don't allow him to pull it back inside.
He just flat out dropped it.
And look at Eli Manning. Oh, man. That's one of those balls you should have caught. But why? You got to give Wansley a little bit of credit. He did rake down through it.
He just dropped.
Oh, gosh, you're killing me. All right.
Wansley, one of the best corners in America. Flags down.
Guess who? Charles Grant.
See if who was offsides. Grant is a man possessed today.
We have offside against the defense. The player was in the neutral zone at the snap.
It might have been David Pollock, the true freshman from Lithonia, Georgia. But Charles Grant, number 19, has come to play.
Yes, he has. He uses a great combination. He's got good leverage. He's got great speed. 6'4", he keeps him away from his body. And he gets great penetration. They say he's got a motor that just keeps on running.
Second and 5 for the Rebels. Joe Gunn met right at the line of scrimmage. Gets it to the 34. And not much further. Dave, let's go back and focus in on the 6'4", 265-pound Grant.
Look at that. See, that's jumping underneath the trap. He's back underneath. When Stackhouse comes out there to block him, he gets his shoulder inside. That negates the trap, and he plays and gets in on the tackle. Exactly what you have to do. You play across the face of that trapper.
Couple of tight ends on a 3rd and 4. Manning finds his man Armstead, and that'll be a Rebel first down. So Ole Miss moving the chains. This drive started at their 20.
This is the kind of drive that Ole Miss needs. Little control of the ball, run out, flood the flat right there. You've got your wide receiver Armstead sitting out there by himself. All you needed was 3 or 4 yards. You just get first down yardage. Nothing, not to be dramatic on the play, not to do anything spectacular, just move those chains, keep it going.
And he fires, pass is caught by Armstead. And a late flag comes flying in. Could be a late hit.
I can tell you that coaches hate that. When you get a foolish penalty, he's out of bounds. Watch this, out in the flat, catches the football, he gets out of bounds. Now he's out of bounds right there. You don't even come close to touching him. You don't do that.
After
that's just
play,
foolish. That's Brandon Williams, 27.
We have a dead ball, personal foul against the defense for a late hit, out of bounds. The penalty is half the distance to the goal from the dead ball spot. Automatic first down.
Ole Miss has certainly improved their offensive flow after the first two drives.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the coaches got their attention too with that 3 and out. We don't want to go out there 3 plays and go out. Got to move the chains. Got to make first downs. Got to keep their defense off the field.
Georgia now penalized three times for 30 yards. Manning. Pass is dropped at the five by Chris Collins. Collins has been battling a high ankle sprain all season long. Didn't actually start today. They gave the start to Bill Flowers, who's played well the last few weeks.
Well, this is a catch you've got to catch. That ball hits him right square, just a little touch behind him. But Collins has got to come down with that ball. That's just, that's one way you got to help your quarterback out.
I'd say for the most part this year, those guys have helped Eli out. It's a pretty good core when you consider Armstrong, Rayford, Collins, Flowers, Armstead. Of course, Stackhouse good at catching the football out of the backfield. Joe Gunn inside the 10. First down marker is set up right at the 1 yard line, so they can make a first down without scoring a touchdown. But now it'll bring up third down and 9. You see the marker on that far side, about a yard and a half shy of the end zone. Three wide receivers. Grant pressure. Manning avoids it. Steps up, fires, caught.
Oh.
Touchdown, Jason Armstead and the Ole Miss Rebels.
Partner, you hit the nail on the head. Jason Armstead, watch him go up for this ball. He dropped one just a minute ago he should have had. Now he goes up and makes a spectacular catch.
And the point after is no good. Jonathan Nichols misses the point after. He was one PAT away from setting a school record. But Ole Miss moves within one behind Eli Manning. Who's your team player?
All right. I'm okay, partner.
Your team player.
I'll save you.
Jonathan Nichols, of course, had a lot of chances at point afters just simply because Ole Miss has put up a lot of points. Ole Miss in the red zone has been phenomenal. They have had 43 opportunities in the red zone this year and have scored 35 touchdowns in 43 opportunities.
Yeah, when we did our makeups for the game, I looked down field goals. I said, man, they've only had four tries. Now you know why. They score touchdowns when they get down there.
Lee Rogers to kick off for the Rebels. Fumbled football. Georgia recovers at the 4. DeCorey Bryant. And now Georgia is backed up against their own end zone.
Well, you want to say he's looking into the sun, but you just got to come on top of that football. He's down right there. Once he makes contact with the ground, now Georgia's got to come out and have a spark. If you're Ole Miss and you're in that defensive huddle and you've just had a kick turned out to the 4 yard line, you're saying, hey, we got to stand up. And that's what Georgia, that's what the fans are calling for him to do. Stand up on defense.
And here come the Ole Miss Rebel fans. They will make some noise as Georgia has a long way to go. And Green rolls to the near side, fires, pass is caught by Terrence Edwards, and just like that, Georgia picks up the first down.
Boy, they do a great job. I love to watch David Green run out on that little roll option where he squares up those big shoulders. He comes out, gets away from a lot of the pressure, squares up, and look at this, thrown against his body, but just throws a strike. That'll get you out of trouble in a hurry, just like you said, Dave.
That's Green's first completion of the day, 1 for 3. And on that completion, picks up 13 yards. Ron Haynes powers his way to the 23 and a half, maybe the 24-yard line. Haynes, of course, scored on Georgia's last possession, a 12-yard touchdown run.
When we were walking down the field, I watched Ron Haynes come out there, and I want to tell you something. Is built like, I mean, he looks like a guard, stocky, about 5'11", about 225. I mean, you talk about put together. That young man is put together.
He wanted to be a basketball player. He had no desire in high school until late to be a football player. JT Wall has the carry for Georgia, and that may be good enough for a
first down. He's out over the 30. Here's some scores. A couple of course, big day for Jefferson Pilot. Three games going on simultaneously. Some of our audience getting to see Kentucky leading Tennessee. That would be a huge, huge blow for the Volunteers. And Clemson with a 6-point lead on South Carolina. Now the Gamecocks are even fielding a team with all their injuries and bumps and bruises. It's amazing. Here's Haynes. He gets a good block from Wall, but nobody blocks Seneca Taylor. And Taylor, the All-SEC corner, comes up with a huge play, a loss of 6.
Boy, and Taylor comes up there. He's about 220 pounds. And everybody says, well, he's put on a few pounds. He's maybe a little heavy. He'd be glad he had that because that's just a face-to-face tackle. And Taylor just doesn't shy away like some cornerbacks would. He comes up and sticks you.
Matter of fact, they've actually played Taylor some at safety this year because of his size. And got some more speed at the corner, moved him to a safety, and you can see why. They don't have a problem with him at safety.
Oh.
Second down and 16 now for the Bulldogs. Play clock ticking down quickly. Gibson in motion. They get it off. Green throws. Tackle by Lanier Gothie. The man who is banged up, and we didn't even know if he'd play today.
Well, I'll tell you this. Gothie plays with his heart. Number two comes after this ball. He gets blocked in there, and look at him just scrambling to get up and get through. Runs through blocks. They want him on the football field.
Third and 22. Ball rest at the right between the 18 and 19, and Green will go from the shotgun. Nearly caught at the 45. Edwards covered by Taylor. Edwards made a nice adjustment and nearly held on.
Boy, and you got to credit Taylor on that play. He makes a nice adjustment, too. Man-to-man down here. Now he knows the ball's coming right there. Look at him looking back up, but he doesn't put his hands on the receiver. He plays the ball all the way. Just can't play it better than that. That was heads-up man-to-man coverage.
Good series by Mr. Taylor.
Yeah, amen.
Jonathan Kilgoe to punt it away. Jonathan, one of 10 finalists for the Ray Guy Award. His net average of 40 yards per punt is best in the SEC. And he hits a rocket. Flags are down, but that punt is taken by Armstead at the 27. Armstead just falls forward to the 34. Flags are down back at the 18, but a great kick by Kilgoe. It traveled 50 yards.
Well, the discussion will be here, Dave. Is it a personal foul or just maybe an offside, something like that? A small penalty. Small penalty, you take the kick.
I think they're going to make Georgia, yes, yeah. Make Georgia repunt it. So they will.
Absolutely. And where the ball would have been on the 34-yard line, now you see what the penalty will be.
We have an illegal formation against the offense. Not enough players on the line of scrimmage. 5-yard penalty, replay fourth down.
Kilgoe will have to go at it again. The junior out of Silver Creek, Georgia.
When you see the difference, the return man standing on the 45-yard line now. He's standing 10 yards farther up.
So Armstead, a great kickoff return man. Third in the NCAA in return average. Now stands at his 45. Another pretty good kick, but very returnable for Armstead. Armstead across midfield to the 47 of Georgia, and that is where the Rebels will have good field position. Eli Manning today, 5 of 10, 33 yards, and a touchdown. He now has 24 touchdowns to just 2 interceptions.
I can't remember when I've ever seen a better ratio. I just
I know they haven't kept that for a lot of years, but that's just the best.
Here's Collins trying to get outside. He can't get past to Corey Bryant. Corey, the sophomore out of Orlando. Georgia's defense has been, last week was on the field quite a bit. I mean, a ton. Their defense was on the field for 39 minutes. Georgia's offense only held the ball for 21 minutes. And Georgia's defense came out the first couple of possessions and played well, but last drive they were on the field as Ole Miss marched it 80 yards, and there is Omar Rayford, the senior wide receiver, hobbling off.
Looks to be in an ankle. Let's see the tail end right here. See if he doesn't get. Yeah, he got pinned right up there. Got his leg rolled on top of your screen.
Omar with 19 catches, a big factor in that passing attack. Here's Armstead, who's seen a lot of action. Brought down at the 43 of Georgia. That is the end of the first quarter. The Georgia Bulldogs lead at 7-6. We shall return to Oxford after this message from Advance Auto Parts. Back in Oxford, Mississippi, where the sky is about as blue as you can get it. 7-6 our score. The Bulldogs lead the Rebels by one. We get set for second quarter action. Ole Miss inside Georgia territory. Ball rest at the Bulldog 43. Rebels looking at a third and 5. Manning. First down Rebels. That goes to Chris Collins.
Well, that's good to see, because what Manning read that time was the full blitz coming on him. They were just flying up inside on him, and he read it real quick, popped it right to his receiver. Watch, he's going to see that pressure from the right. Get rid of the football quickly. Collins comes down with the catch, move the chains, get a first down. You know, I just get the feeling that Eli is not into his flow, because he's a streak quarterback. He'll go 7, 8, 9, 10 passes in a row, just perfect on mark.
Well, he opened the season with 18 straight. Yeah. At 18 straight completions. The Rebels' first game of the season. Looking for Collins. That's off the back of the helmet of DeCorey Bryant. No flag at the 10-yard line.
Good coverage out there. That's one-on-one. Tough, tough coverage. When you're running with that wide receiver, that's tough.
Cat Rental Store first quarter stats look like this. Georgia with 34 rushing yards. ...51 total yards for the Ole Miss Rebels. Georgia had some big penalties in the Ole Miss touchdown drive on Rebels' last possession. Manning. Incomplete. Look for Stackhouse. Big hit at the 35-yard line by Will Witherspoon. William Witherspoon actually been a babysitter for the coaches during his time at Georgia.
When he got a, I'll tell you, that time he almost, Marcus Johnson almost had a hold on David Pollock that time. They're trying to get pressure up the middle on him, and they just yanked him down. But they got away with it, Dave.
It's not a penalty unless you get caught.
That's exactly right. Well, right now, Eli Manning needs to find somebody. Don't throw that fade. Throw one of that crossing patterns, maybe a little post pattern, but something to move the chains, pick up some yardage.
Sanford tripped up at the 30. What will Ole Miss do? Rebels are 10 for 13 on fourth down conversions this year. That's best in the Southeastern Conference. But Coach Cutcliffe will kick it.
This is going to be a kick, too.
Ball rest at the 38, so it'll be a 48-yard field goal attempt. It is up and no good. Lee Rogers misses it. No points for the Rebels. The Dogs still lead by one. We'll return to Oxford after this timeout. in Oxford, second quarter. 40th meeting between these two teams that have met every year since 1966. But next year will be the last year that they will play for a few times as they begin to switch up teams. And Georgia will face some other SEC Western Division opponents. Alabama actually comes into the fold for Georgia. But Ole Miss will make a return trip to Athens next year. Fred Gibson in motion as Georgia has it first and 10. Green in that shotgun. Pump fakes. Now goes deep. Looking for his big play man, Gibson, and he goes through his fingertips and a flag down at the 21. Justin Coleman, who has the best speed among that Ole Miss secondary core on the coverage.
And Dave, this is a pump fake, and he sends him long. Look him off there now. Look back over to where he is. And what Coleman does is he puts his hand on him way on the right of your screen. You'll see that left hand reach up and hook him right there. You see that left hand up on his shoulder? Can't do that. And he'd been fine if he just would run with him, not put that hand up. Put that hand up. They see it all the time.
However, anytime Gibson goes deep, I don't think it's a real bad play to
have speed.
Pass interference. I mean, this guy has four straight 100-yard games, which is a school record. Overall record for the school is 7 in a career.
Okay? Yeah, I know.
He's a true freshman, is Fred Gibson, and redshirt freshman quarterback David Green's throwing to him. Is that a dangerous combination? Green over the middle, as his tight end, Randy McMichael, and McMichael is gang tackled, led by Ryan Hamilton. Gain of about 4.
And Dave, just to follow up, I talked to Mark Rick coming out about Fred Gibson. He said, let me tell you something, he doesn't know what's going on now. He said, wait till he learns the offense. He said, right now in the huddle, they'll tell him what pass patterns to run. He's just trying to learn this offense. He said, you just wait till he learns it.
Here's Haynes. He'll pick up a Georgia first down. Brought down at the 42. A pickup of 10 for Veron. Matt Greer from his safety spot on the tackle.
Well, there's a lot of ways to measure a running back, and vision is something that you just can't coach. And when you get somebody like Veron Haynes, he runs in, it looks like he's going to the two hole, which is that guard center gap, and he kicks it back outside the offensive tackle. You know that he's seeing the hole develop.
Haynes again. Georgia's offensive line with a good surge, and we're talking about an offensive line that got a couple of 300 pounders leading the way for that man, Veron Haynes.
Well, he's been something running up in there, seen that little hole, stumbled on that play. Now take it, seat back inside, just keep on digging. You see the great leg strength he has. He has been superb, then runs in the end zone. He scored the touchdown untouched.
Haynes now 9 carries, 45 yards. Starting a tailback. Haynes tackled by Eddie Strong. Just a couple on that play.
Well, I can tell you, if I'm in that offensive huddle and you get one of those running backs that's really kind of churning it up and getting that little in that move or groove, you just go right back to him. Third down and one or two. Hey, so here we go, Veron. It's your turn again.
Georgia 0-for-2 on third down conversions today. Mark Rick said his team had to find a way to run the football, had to keep the defense off the field. They've run it pretty successfully today. A couple of tight ends, the pitch. That goes to Jasper Shanks. He's very close to a first down. Lanier Gothy, the middle linebacker, met him first.
Boy, did Shanks put his head down on that play. Haynes was the lead block on it, but Sanks got hit about 2 yards from the line of scrimmage. And I mean, he just put his head down. Watch 28 there. That's Gothy. That's the middle linebacker.
Knocked his helmet right off.
That's a smack.
Well, Georgia needs a yard. Last time they needed a yard was in Auburn.
Yeah. And they went to Jasper Sanks, and he didn't make it.
Well, the game not on the line right here, but certainly an important drive. And they give it to Haynes, the fullback, and he'll have it.
Haynes on the carry on the left side.
Of
Boy, he didn't make it by much. This is good line surge right here, both sides. They come up right there. He doesn't have it. But watch right there. You see how he leans forward and falls forward. The official coming in, there's the dead ball sign, marks the spot, and they do make that first down.
Haynes played some high school ball in Atlanta, but grew up in the Bronx, New York.
Yeah, he walked on, didn't he? Out of Western Kentucky, I remember that.
Green picked off. Picked off at the 20-yard line by Rob Robertson, the redshirt freshman. His first interception of the season.
All right, David Green never saw him. You're going to see number 81 drift. He's right in the center, just reading the quarterback. And look, he's perfect, right in spot. The ball is intended out there. Looks like it's going out to Edwards. Look at this. He never saw him. Just threw it right there, right in his hands. Heads up play by Robertson.
Really, one of the reasons that he's playing is because of some injuries to LP Spence. But for David Green, his seventh interception this season. Green only 11 yards passing today. He came in having thrown for over 2,200 yards. Manning on first down. His pass is caught. Gain of about four, right near the 30-yard line. Trey Freifogel on the reception. Thornton on the coverage.
Number seven, Bruce Thornton of Georgia.
When these corners for Georgia are just playing great football. I mean, they're coming up. Thornton's been, he's been abused a little bit. He's a sophomore. He's tender, but he comes up on that play and stops him for just a yard or two loss. I mean, gain, I should say.
Checking off the line of scrimmage on second down. It's his hot receiver, and that'll be a first down. Chris Collins, Thornton on the coverage. Collins leads the team in receptions, came in with 40 catches this season.
And this is right off the ground. Look how low that ball was. Watch this right here. Down, away from him. That's a marvelous catch. Talk about concentration. You got to get your hands out there. When that ball hits him, you can't bottle it because you got the defender right on you. That's what Collins did on that play.
Oh, great play action. Manning has his tight end. Ziegler gets flipped over at midfield. They'll say he's down right at the midfield stripe. No fumble. DeCorey Bryant on the tackle, but a first down by the Rebels.
Well, and the play fake, when I saw the play fake to Joe Gunn, I just assumed he had the ball going around the top end. Great play fake right in there. Now just come back off, hide the football, roll out there, square up, find your receiver. Does a great job finding Ziegler.
Ziegler. Five receptions for 102 yards versus Arkansas. Williams fumbles the football. George is going to pick it up at the 42. Tony Gilbert. The hit was caused by DeCorey Bryant. And Georgia forces a turnover in Ole Miss territory. We'll see what they do with it. Let me come back after a word from your local stations.
9:17 to play.
Georgia needed to create something defensively. They did so with a fumble. Eli Manning threw it out to the flat. DeCorey Bryant stepped up with the big hit.
Yeah, and Tony Gilbert came over there, and he falls on the ball. Now, what they do is they teach offensive and defensive linemen to fall on the ball, but when you're a linebacker, they say pick it up and run.
He had nothing but goal lines and headlines in front of him. That is Tony Gilbert. But Georgia does have good field position. They pick up a couple on first down. At halftime, we'll be taking a look at the Altel halftime stats. Scott Kruszwanski will have more as well, and there's an injured Rebel at the 38-yard line. That's Kenny Jackson, the senior out of New Orleans, Louisiana, the biggest man they have up front, who, as you and I were talking yesterday, Dave, it's so rare to see a defensive lineman among the top two or three on a team in tackles, but this defensive tackle has 74 stops this year.
Yeah, number two tackler. He slides the line well. He's got a great speed and balance in there. Doesn't get knocked off his feet. They don't want to lose him. They'll probably bring in Jesse Mitchell, number 95, to replace him. But Jackson just sits there.
Let's go down to Scott Przewanski down on the sidelines, who has an update on another injured player earlier, Omar Rayford.
Yeah, that's right. When they do get back on the field, the offense for Ole Miss, they will be without Omar Rayford. You can see he's got an ankle sprain on the right side. They've got it taped and iced. They hope to work him out a little bit at halftime, see if he can come back into the game. But right now, it looks very doubtful for Omar Rayford. Back up to you guys.
Thank you, Scott. And Kenny Jackson being helped off as well, and that does not look good.
No. When you come off like that, you're a defensive lineman, you're hurting. But what a good football player he is.
And Doug Ziegler, the tight end, heading to the Ole Miss locker room as well. So in succession, Ole Miss suffering what could be critical injuries here in the second quarter. 8-10 to go before halftime. Second down and 7 for the Dogs. Formation, but Green will throw it. He lofts it up, looking for Gibson. Green got hit as he let it go. Coleman on the coverage.
Boy, Doug Ziegler, they can't afford to lose him. You know, when he came down on that arm, it looked like they put a cast, one of those air casts on it, David, when they got him over to the sideline. That's not a good sign.
He's a good target for Eli Manning. 21 catches this season. Right now, Ole Miss will worry about trying to stop Georgia on his 3rd and 7, but a flag has been thrown.
Infraction against the offense. 12 players breaking out of the huddle. 5-yard penalty. Still 3rd down.
That is a no-no, and that'll move Georgia back 5, and that'll bring up 3rd and 12. Georgia on 3rd down is last in the Southeastern Conference this year. They are converting 3rd downs at a rate of 28%. They are 0-for-3 today. Green stumbles and fires. Looking for LeBron Mitchell, who made the catch but is out of bounds. Very close to an unbelievable reception for Mitchell.
I think what they called him, as you said, Davey, was out of bounds because that was a tie. The tie goes to the wide receiver. Nobody dropped this football. Somebody came down with it. Now let's watch the tail end right there. There's the catch. The foot's
down. That's a catch.
Yes. Yes.
That is a catch. Clear as day. Yeah. A foot is inbounds. Watch. Left foot inbounds.
Perfect.
That's a catch.
Absolutely. I thought the official called it a tie and he was out of bounds, but tie goes to the wide receiver.
Georgia has to punt it away. And a fair catch at the 6-yard line. Well, I tell you, that's a tough break for the Georgia Bulldogs. That would have been down there at the 10-yard line. Anyway, Ole Miss will take it at the 6. They got a long way to go.
Boy, if you ever get the feeling that you're watching two offenses just sputter, neither one really doing anything, not moving with any consistency. Eli Manning not having the day that we're used to seeing him have. David Green not having a very good day either.
Green 3 of 8 for 11 yards with an interception. Manning 14 of 21, 74 yards, but he does have a touchdown. Manning to throw. Pass is caught by Armstrong. Let's take a look at some SEC scores. Kentucky still leading Tennessee. How about that Kentucky defense that has been maligned all season with injuries and hardly any depth, right now holding Tennessee scoreless. Of course, that game on Jefferson Pilot for some of our audience, and this one also, Carolina area, South Carolina and Clemson going at it. There's a couple of wars. 2nd down and 3. Tony Gilbert hanging on. He makes the tackle on Joe Gunn. That'll be shy of the 1st down.
When I like watching Gilbert play, middle linebackers, you got to be just fearless. You got to slide to the football. You got to stick your nose right in the middle of those numbers. That's what Gilbert does.
Mention these offenses, Dave. They came in here pretty explosive. Total offense, Ole Miss was 4th in the SEC. Georgia
was third in the SEC, but so far the deep story's been defense.
It has.
Stackhouse bounces off a couple of defenders. First down Rebels out near the 24. That is a lot of man coming at you. 6'3", 245 pounds, the senior out of West Memphis.
Well, that's why I don't like quarterback sneaks. I've never liked it. Quarterback standing flat-footed. Third down and one. He's got no momentum. That's why you give it to a Charles Stackhouse. He puts his head down. He's the one that's designed to carry the football in short yardage, and he picks up the first down.
He's played a couple of games at tailback this year. Joe Gunn was hurt. Nothing happening on that play. Maybe lost one. That is Robert Williams. Ken Veal, who is stepping in for David Jacobs. Of course, those of you joining us, David Jacobs, a real leader on the defensive front for Georgia. We talked about it in the open. Back in Atlanta at Emory University Hospital. Neurological problems, issues this week in Georgia to avoid any further problems. Sent him to intensive care to have it worked out. Ross Bailey a little shaken up as well. But, Dave, you talked to Coach Van Gorder about that earlier.
Oh, yeah. He said the one person that they could not lose and play solid defense, they felt, was David Jacobs, and they lost him.
First down, Rebels. Jason Armstead again. Armstead has been a factor since the get-go today.
Well, is Eli Manning getting back into flow now? This is just thread. Look at the people he throws between. Talk about the old thread in the needle. That's thread in the needle. Maybe he's getting back into that little bit of the groove that he gets in. When he gets hot, let me tell you, he's unstoppable.
Armstead catches it again. Thornton on the stop. Penalty assessed against Ole Miss moments ago, and an illegal shift by the Rebels. Moves it back five, so it's first and 15 at the 35. Manning throws, caught by Williams. It's a couple on the play. Wansley on the coverage.
Dave, I can tell you a mark of a good defensive team, and it's what happens after the receiver catches the ball. Now watch this. Out in the flat, look at the closing speed that you see Wansley, number two, come up there with. Once you catch that football, now you talk about wrapping them up.
Brian Van Gorder, the defensive coordinator. His defense has only given up 21 points. Now, total yards given up, over 400 per game. But as Coach Rick likes to tell us, it's all about keeping them out of the end zone. He'd like to see that yardage cut down. But nonetheless, Georgia's defense has been pretty successful. That's fourth best in the Southeastern Conference in terms of yards or points given up.
Well, that's the important stat. Everybody will tell you at the end of the season, everybody reads those stats, and we're only giving up this many yards. We're only giving up those many yards. But when you get to the end of the year, it's W's and L's.
Third down. Ole Miss has converted 6 of 9 today. Pretty successful. Four receivers. Georgia bringing some pressure. Manning gets hit. Pass is caught by Collins, but that is shy of the first down by about a yard, maybe a yard and a half.
Yeah, when Collins caught that ball, and it's just a quick out, he stumbled a little bit, and when he got his balance, he actually ran back.
Again, David Cutcliffe will punt it away.
Yeah, out in the flat when he hits the football. He's got the first down there, but you see how he stumbles? And he actually runs back.
And Coach Cutcliffe playing a game of field position at this point. Although Georgia's had good field position most of the game and has only scored one touchdown. Gary will call for the fair catch at the 15. Georgia's first two drives started around midfield. This one will start at the 15. Back to Oxford right after this. Seven to six our score. Second quarter action. 3:11 to go before halftime. Dave Rowe, Scott Przewanski on the sidelines. I'm Dave Neal. Glad you could join us. First and 10, handoff goes to Veron Haynes. Out 20. Lanier Gothy. Lanier Gothy's a guy that has a foot problem that has really caused him to maybe twist his ankle, and then the problem goes up into his calf, and it's been a real issue. It's a strange situation with him, and it's kind of a birth defect, if you will, the way his foot, the bone in his foot sits. And we didn't think he'd play today.
He's played, and he's played well.
That he has. Picked off by Ole Miss! Vaughn Hutchins with his first interception. It was batted in the air by Seneker Taylor, and Hutchins brought it in, and Ole Miss is in business.
Well, when you throw the long pass and your coverage is this good, watch Taylor go up and tip the ball right there. And here comes number 5, Vaughn Hutchins, and he just heads up play. Old defensive backs, what they do, they react to the football. It's up in the air. It's called fire, fire, and everybody looks up to see where the ball is, and that's what Hutchins did there.
Hutchins has been a real plus for the Rebels the last few games. He's not real big, but Don Lindsay, the defensive coordinator, told us he's kind of the quarterback back there.
Yep. He's one of those kids that jumps out at you. That's what they say. Their numbers jump out at you.
Green with 2 interceptions in the first half. Gilbert pressures Manning, who throws to the end zone, but a flag down. Vieira on the coverage of Jamie Armstrong, but a flag lays down on the 1-yard line.
And that flag was thrown really early, so I think what you're going to find is you're going to find Vieira interfering with the route, holding him on the route.
Ryan Van Gorder, defensive coordinator, looking on. Gilbert put some heat on Manning. He just was about a step behind.
Yes, he was. And you notice how they're rolling away from him, taking that pocket and rolling away.
We have holding against the defense. The penalty will be half the distance from the previous spot. Because the hold was against an eligible receiver, it's an automatic first down.
Thank you very much, Rogers. Redding. 6 penalties, 47 yards against Georgia. 3 for 27 against the Rebels. So it'll be first and goal. The ball rests at the 8-yard line. 2:22 to go before halftime. I formation, Stackhouse the fullback. Joe Gunn gets the handoff and takes it close to the 5. Remember the success of the Rebel offense in the red zone this year. 43 opportunities, counting today's touchdown. They have 35 TDs. I mean, that is unbelievable. Counting today, they are 35 of 43. 35 touchdowns, 43 opportunities in the red zone.
And they're not thinking field goal here, Dave. They're thinking touchdown. That's all they want.
Coach Cutcliffe told us it's all about getting your playmakers on the field. Let them make the plays. We'll see who the playmaker is. On this one, Manning, under pressure, throws it out of bounds.
Wait a minute. He's in the pocket.
There's a flag. Charles Grant is the man who got a hand on him. There was a tight end down around the 2-yard line. I couldn't see if Ziegler was back. It was actually Bo Hartsfield, number 34, the tight end.
Forward pass, intentional grounding. There was no receiver in the area. The ball did not cross the line of scrimmage. Loss of down at the spot of the foul. Third down.
Now watch this. You're going to see right side. Watch. Here comes Charles Grant. He's got him right there. He throws down the flat. There's nobody close to there.
Well,
close is a relative word, I guess.
What is close? Define close.
Well,
I don't know, Dave. I got to tell you, Hartsfield's, the ball landed at about the 5. Hartsfield's at the 2. I mean, what determines what's close?
Well, it wasn't intended for him. That's what I didn't think it was intended for him. He was under duress. He was going down. He was in the arms of the defender.
All right, well, that makes up. That'll make up for the missed catch on Mitchell, Georgia's LeBron Mitchell.
Okay.
Manning scrambles, nowhere to go, gets hit right in the jaws. He lets it go. Chris Clemens.
Boy, when you roll to that corner right there, you just don't have a whole lot of area to throw to. And boy, did he take a shot right up in the nose.
And Peyton Manning, Eli's brother, has a hairline fracture on his jaw.
From that very same thing.
From a hit very similar to that.
Absolutely. Well, here's a rarity, a field goal try.
Lee Rogers. Up and good from 37 yards. He missed from 48 earlier. And Ole Miss takes the lead 9-7 with a minute 22 to go before halftime. There is Mr. Archie Manning, who of course has faced the Georgia Bulldogs in his time as the Ole Miss quarterback with 2-1, 7 TDs in 3 games, but also had 7 INTs. Led him to victory, 1969.
And I'll tell you this, I like the new glasses, Archie. new specs. You remember the ones he wore the last few times we've seen him. I think he took a lot of heat for that.
He and Olivia here in Oxford, really, I've seen them all over the place. Yeah. They're following Eli around. Why not? Putting on a pretty good show. If you're just a college football fan, you'd like to follow him around. Georgia lets it sail through the end zone. And they'll take over at the 20. David Green with 2 interceptions today. Came in with 6 interceptions this season.
Well, they've got a minute 22 left. They've just done nothing on offense. Sputtered all day long. See if they just don't go back to basic. Maybe try to run a little bit. If they get a break, get out towards 35, 40 yard lines, then have Green throw some nice solid passes. But what you want to do with your quarterback in here, you don't want to send him into the locker room at halftime with 2 interceptions.
Green over the middle. Pass is caught by Damian Gary. That'll stop the clock for a moment. They move the chains.
Did you see Damian Gary go, throw it up a little bit higher. I was going to run with that
one. Yeah, he had a lot of room.
Oh, he did, Dave. But you want your quarterback to go in that halftime with a positive note. Maybe a field goal try at the worst. Touchdown if you can get it, but let him go in with some confidence, especially when he's young.
Green now 5 of 11 after that completion, and Ole Miss keeps him inbounds. Clock runs. George will probably burn a timeout.
Damian Gary.
And they do. Georgia takes a timeout. That'll stop the clock with 57 seconds to go.
Well, when you throw it out in the flat pass here and you see people coming, what you do is just get out of bounds. Save that timeout. You're not going to pick up, you're not going to split 2 good defensive backs. Just get out of bounds.
David Green had completed 61% of his passes, which would be the 4th best number in Georgia history. But today, though, that number dropping a little bit. He's just 5 of 11. Actually, the school record holder in that department in terms of completion percentage for a season is Mike Bobo, who is the Georgia quarterback coach currently.
We're seeing a lot of great years with Mike Bobo.
Bobo completed 65% of his passes.
Unbelievable. And that's not dumping him to the backs either.
Well, there are some injuries that Ole Miss will have to worry about. Georgia came in worrying about injuries, specifically up front, but today Ole Miss is the one banged up, and there is Mr. Bobo.
Yeah, there's Mike.
Mike Bobo, former Georgia quarterback, now working with the young one, David Green. And Mike Bobo, very high on David Green. Just all the tools you look for in a quarterback. Certainly they'll have David for a few more years, just a redshirt freshman. Green under pressure, sacked at the 29. Jesse Mitchell out of Moss Point, Mississippi, with his 2nd sack of the season.
Boy, and this will change the complexion of a hurry-up offense. Jesse Mitchell just burst through there. You can see Green, when he's tried to step up, he didn't know what to do. He just was under fire and went down with the ball. Now this is where you just want to take the lead into the halftime. You just want to take what you got into the halftime. You don't want to risk it here.
Georgia Hand off to Veron Haynes, and they were just trying to run out the clock, and now they may have to rethink it. First down, out over midfield to the 46 goes Veron Haynes, a gain of 23, 11 seconds to go before halftime.
Boy, and JT Wall got a good block on Eddie Strong, the outside backer. Watch Wall come up here, 49, right there. See him drive him off. Now Veron Haynes just takes it, bursts up. All of a sudden, they got a first down there inside the 50-yard line. Hey, wait a minute. 11 seconds, you might complete one, get a nice field goal try.
Georgia uses a timeout. JT Wall, 6 foot, 240-pounder out of Milledgeville, Georgia. Didn't expect to start. Only carried four times for 22 yards, but with the injuries to Musa Smith, Jasper Sanks, not really a factor today. So JT getting a lot of work at that fullback spot.
Well, you've got 11 seconds on the clock. You've got a timeout, so you can throw it down, but you've got to get somewhere probably around the 30-yard line, so you've got to pick up in that 12, 15, 16-yard range.
Haynes, 14 carries now as you look at Billy Bennett, Georgia's field goal kicker. Had a couple blocked last week. But Haynes, 14 of 79 today on the ground, averaging 5.6 per carry. Haynes has been a big factor. One thing about Veron Haynes before we go to halftime, he's a guy that organizes a group of players every week to make weekly visits to a hospital in an Athens area. Amazing character, Veron Haynes. Green. Down he goes at the 45. He is swarmed by a pile of blue jerseys. Jesse Mitchell was the first man on the spot when they got off the pile, his second sack today. So Ole Miss will take a two-point lead into the locker room, trying to break a streak where Georgia's won four in a row in this series. And Ole Miss under Cutcliffe, 20-4 when they lead at halftime, 5-0 this year. Let's check in with Scott Przewanski. Scott.
Coach Mark Rick, down 9-7. What are you going to tell these guys headed in?
Just defense got to keep it up, and offense got to keep from turning the ball over. That's the big thing. Just giving them too many opportunities, and thankfully our defense is playing as stout as they've done all year.
Any words for your offensive encouragement for your quarterback?
Well, you just got to make the play, that's all.
Okay, that's head coach Mark Rick. He's going to get that quarterback, David Green, to make the play. You better believe it. The Bulldogs trailing 9-7. Your halftime festivities are coming up from Oxford in just a few moments.
In the background, and Ole Miss fans are happy to lead by two. Last year, they led 14-0, but Georgia rolled to a victory, and there is that expansion, $25 million. But right now, our $25 million man, Scott Przewanski, is down the sidelines with David Cutcliffe. Guys.
David, only 9 points in the first half. I think folks expected more out of your offense.
Well, we certainly made enough mistakes to last us for two or three ball games and put ourselves in some bad situations. We've got to execute better. We're also going to have to block them better than we have, no question about that.
Anything specific you're looking for from your group?
Well, certainly we need to protect the passer. Let him get comfortable in the pocket. We got to get the ball thrown downfield a little bit. I want to see us to be able to get the ball outside, running the ball some. They stacked up everything inside. We need to find some perimeter offense this half.
Okay, Coach.
Thank you very much, Scott. There's Eli Manning. Eli, 18 of 27, 105 yards, has a touchdown, no interceptions. Long pass, only covered 17 yards. John Latina, the offensive coordinator. David Cutcliffe talking to Joe Gunn, who has been very quiet. Joe Gunn running the football, 8 carries, 11 yards. David Green on the other side. Well, his day not much better than anybody else's out here. 5 of 11, 2 interceptions, total 30 yards. And he does have one reception that covered 16 yards.
And you know, it's interesting, as you talk to head coaches, they'll always say, well, we need to block better. What happens is both quarterbacks are not having great days. And David Green especially throwing 2 interceptions. One of them just inexcusable, just did not see the coverage drift right in there. For Eli Manning, it's not been a very productive day for him either. We're used to him throwing 8-10 yard drives and long passes and just building up yards.
How about Georgia's defense? 9 points to a team that has averaging 38.8 points per game. The cap to the Dog defense as well as this Ole Miss defense. Who would have thought we'd had a defensive struggle today? But we got one. Georgia will take over at the 20-yard line. Here is David Green's numbers. Green, the redshirt freshman out of Lithonia, Georgia. Goes to 6'3", around 215, 220 pounds. He's actually caught a pass. Caught one last week. His play fake. He had a great play fake against Auburn last week that was just unbelievable. Both these quarterbacks today are tremendous. Sometimes that's a lost art among some of the younger quarterbacks, but these two guys love to play action, love to play fake. This time they give it straight to Veron Haynes. Haynes picks up 4 or 5 on the play.
And Dave, one of the things that you're not seeing is you're not seeing anybody get knocked down. So they're not, you know, doing those old decleaters where you got people on the ground and you see the little seams break and go through. Ole Miss running to the football well. All their linemen are up. Their linebackers are flowing nicely to the flow. Misdirection is probably the way to go in this offensive scheme for Georgia because Ole Miss is just flying to the football.
Second down and 7. I formation. There's the handoff to Haynes. He's out over the 30. First down. That's a gain of about 8 on the play.
Now that's the kind of play that really used to hurt me. When I played, that quick hitter pops right up and pops right up in the line. Before you can get shed of your block and slide over into place, it's into the secondary and you're just trying to grab on and trail from behind. But a nice run that time by Haynes.
Justin Coleman in that secondary will keep an eye on David Green on a first and 10. Georgia wanted to run the football today. They are making a concerted effort to really keep the defense off the field. And it didn't really work. I mean, they carried the ball. Veron Haynes did successfully, but they still lost out in the time of possession by over five minutes.
Well, they gave it up. You remember they gave it up quickly. Three and out. And we talked about that early. They've made their adjustments. They're going to try to pound the ball inside, maybe get to the edge a little bit, but they've got two fullbacks playing at running back now.
Haynes staying on his feet, close to the first down marker. I think you'll have it. The marker was at the 42, and he's brought down close to the 43.
And Dave, when you have two fullbacks, you're thinking tackle to tackle, and that's exactly where they're running. Inside, you've got JT Walls about 255 pounds. You got Veron Haynes at about 225. They're fullback type runners. They're not going to get to that outside to be that scat bat making it around the outside edge.
Haynes now 1 yard shy of 100. Take a breather for a moment. There's Sanks. First down and then some into Ole Miss territory. Matt Greer finally brings down Jasper Sanks. So Sanks, who sat down on the bench for most of this game, certainly made his presence felt on that carry.
Yeah, he beat Justin Coleman. He just ran over him. He's got that great big body. And when you come up there, you just kind of bounce off and you can't really wrap up because he's so wide-shouldered in there.
Senior, 235 pounds, gets the toss. Taking that 235 for another first down near the 25.
Dave, what makes that play work is that Sanks has got that little bit of burst of speed where he can get a little bit better outside rush than what can Haynes or Wall inside. They're bruising type. You bring in Sanks, you get a little bit of change of pace. Flip it to him, let him get it outside a little bit.
First and 10, Georgia. Nice opening drive for the Dogs. They've done it on the ground. Veron Haynes. Haynes with a nice stutter step. Down to the 1 yard line. They'll mark him back at the 3. They'll say his knee hit at the 3 yard line, but Haynes came in at the fullback spot while Sanks stayed at the tailback.
Exactly, and look at this, right up the middle. Great hole blocking up front there. Look at that little stutter step right there. He makes a miss. Finally, Gothy gets him, but that is a great, watch this little stutter step right back inside. Boom, you freeze that safety, and he locks those feet down, and he almost stretches to the end zone. It's a great drive.
Haynes now 124 yards on 18 carries. Sinks will take it to the one.
And this is a tone setter. You come out here, you take the football on the 20-yard line, and you drive it down the field. You set the tone for the second half. And that's what Georgia's done.
How about this? This will be the ninth play of the drive. The eight previous plays, all rushes. And they have acquired 79 yards. Make it 80. Flags are down in the end zone, but Georgia. Jasper Sinks gets into the end zone.
Everybody holds their breath trying to figure out what
the touchdown is good. We have illegal participation. Illegal participation, 12 men on the field against the defense. That penalty is declined. Touchdown.
So the combination of Haynes and Sinks get it done.
Yep, for the 1 yard line, and Jasper Sinks this time goes into the end zone.
Oh, the Dogs would love to have had that a week ago. Jasper Sinks with his second rushing touchdown this season. And here comes Billy Bennett for the point after. It is perfect. Ron Haynes, 124 yards on the ground. Got some help from this man, Jasper Sinks. The Dogs retake the lead, 14-9. Two weeks ago, Ole Miss and Arkansas played in the longest game in NCAA history, a 7-overtime affair. And on the last play, Razorback Jermaine Petty stopped Doug Ziegler to give Arkansas a 58-56 win. And in similar fashion last week between the hedges, Auburn stopped Georgia's Jasper Sinks on the goal line and watched as time ticked away as they escaped with a 24-17 victory. And this last play from 1 yard out, the Bulldogs make it. A 9-play drive, capped off by Sinks' touchdown run. All plays were rushing. We'll see what Ole Miss does on their first possession. Armstead out over the 35 to the 36, and a huge block back around the 10-yard line that really sprung Armstead, who is third in the NCAA in kickoff returns, averaging 33 per return.
Well, you don't usually think about people returning it from about 4 or 5 yards deep in there. But you're right, he gets a couple good blocks, makes a couple misdirections right there. He just seems to follow that little seam, find that little hole. They got great field position, 35-yard line.
Armstead's been a factor all day today. Stackhouse goes in motion. Manning to throw on first down. Swings it out to Gunn, who stumbled and loses 5 on the play, maybe 6. Jermaine Phillips came rolling up on Gunn, and he records his 4th tackle of the afternoon.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see the changes that the Ole Miss offensive and defensive staffs have made at halftime. Eli Manning didn't enjoy a very good first half. David Green didn't. David Green, they fixed him. They ran the ball 9 times in a row.
They say it's a loss of 5. They being the official scores. Second down and 15. And you can add some more negative yardage to Ole Miss. Boss Bailey gets in there in a hurry to record the tackle for loss.
Hey, I could make this sack when you're untouched. And that's exactly what he is. Watch 45 right there, untouched. And he just rolls over top of Eli Manning. That's a freebie.
For Boss Bailey, that's his first sack of the season. He does have now 6 tackles for loss. Third down and 22. Georgia late getting in some players. Wansley coming on a blitz from his corner, but the handoff takes it to the 25. It goes to Robert Williams. The crowd not happy with the call.
No, they want to see Eli Manning pass the football. He tried to run a little draw play, and it's not a bad play. Third down and about, what'd you say, 24, 25 yards? You don't try to throw that football up. You need too many yards. You take a chance, hope you can break something. Didn't work.
Ridgeway on to punt for Ole Miss. Cody today averaging 39 yards a kick. It is a bomb.
Wow.
Over the head of Gary. That'll roll into the end zone. A 75-yard punt. His longest was 54, but you can erase that from the books. It's 75. Georgia leads Ole Miss 14-9 on this November Saturday in Oxford, Mississippi. Third quarter action, 8:53 to go. And Ole Miss behind a 75-yard punt by Cody Ridgway gives the ball up to the Georgia Bulldogs. David Green under center. Handoff near the 24-yard line. And there have been, we've talked about it, injuries galore to Ole Miss in the first half. And for an update on those injuries, let's go down to the sidelines to Scott Przewanski. Scott?
Yeah, Dave, more injuries to report for the Ole Miss offense. And bad news, too. Omar Rayford sprained that ankle. He won't return. And Doug Ziegler, the outstanding tight end, fractured his forearm. He, too, is lost for the game. And right now, out on the field for the defense, you will not see number 92, Kenny Jackson. He's got a bruised calf. They're hopeful he may return.
Man, oh man, bad day for injuries at Ole Miss. Defense steps up, makes a nice play there. Kenny Jackson, who we mentioned with a bad ankle, second leading tackler. That'll hurt to not have him. So guys like Charlie Anderson will have to play and play their tail off.
Yeah, they'll have to step up. And right now, if you're in the Georgia defensive huddle, they've run, what, 10, 11 plays in a row? 11 straight runs, Dave, you've got to stop it. Somebody's got to step up there because they won't leave it.
Third and four. We'll see what the Bulldogs can do here. Lanier Gothy looking at 35 and white because Haynes has had a huge day. They play fake to Haynes. Throw it to the fullback. Look at JT Wall get out over the 35. First down for the Bulldogs. Lanier Gothy with his seventh stop of the afternoon.
How about the yards rushing? Just rushing that football, running up in the middle. They have come out. They've just set a tone. They have just controlled the second half with their running game. They've gotten it from a lot of different people, too. We've watched Wall. We've watched Haynes. We've watched Jasper Sanks go in for the score.
Here's Wall, who falls forward near the 40. Good effort by JT. Ryan Hamilton and Corey Robinson combined for the stop. Give him a gain of four on that, but the offensive line deserves a lot of credit, Dave. You look at those big guys up front, Marshall, McGill, Jackson, Stinchcomb, Breedlove. The big boys up front make it all happen.
Yeah, they have a block there that they call the dominator block. And what it is when you dominate your opponent. And I'll tell you right now, they're dominating the line of scrimmage. Somebody from Ole Miss has got to get penetration. You've got to send some pressure. You've got to stop the run.
Haynes driving out over the 40 to the 41. That'll bring up another third down. And Moussa Smith over there wearing number 32. The Georgia's leading rusher has been battling injuries really all season long. He ran for 144 yards last year against the Rebels, but a pulled groin, a hip flexor combination have caused him to watch this from the sidelines. But Georgia has found a way to run the football today with Haynes at tailback, and Sanks has spelled him a little bit in that spot as well. Third and five from the 41. A big third down. Gibson in motion. Green has all day. He's going deep looking for Gary. And Gary makes the catch at the 15. What a play by Damian Gary, the sophomore out of Athens, Georgia.
Boy, you got to credit that offensive line. McGill up there just blocking himself. You're looking up there, ripping out there to the center. Gives the quarterback a lot of time to go back. Now, Damian Gary goes up for the football. He's looking back. He knows the ball's coming his way. Defender's just trying to play him right there. Coleman, he lets Damian Gary go way up high to catch it, almost like a basketball rebound.
A gain of 46 yards. Gary, a guy that has been battling injuries. He's been bothered by a bad back for the last month, but it didn't look like it affected him on that catch. A hand handoff to the up man, Wall, gets nothing, maybe lost a half a yard.
Dave, when you start talking about defense, you've got to have your stallions up front. When you take a Kenny Jackson out of there, that really depletes your defensive line.
Folks, when you're on the road to watch SEC football this season, plan on eating at Huddle House, where you can order their Big House breakfast and lunch platters anytime. That includes 24 hours a day. Second down and 10, Jasper Sanks in a tailback. And the pitch goes to the senior. Sanks, flag down. Couple of flags down.
Yeah, that's going to be holding, I'm sure, against Georgia from where it was thrown. That's what it looked like. Yep. We may see that right on the out there. Oh, look at that. That's what you call a takedown. Wow. That's a takedown.
Kareem Marshall, 75.
Yep. We have holding against the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replay second down.
Thank you, Rogers Redding, and that'll move him back. But Big Kareem with a nice nice power move, though.
Yeah, it was good takedown. He locked up with him, and he's a big guy. 6'6", 335. I'm getting a chance to get out there, and he just locked up and said, I'm just throwing you down.
We chuckle about the takedown, but Mark Richt does not, because that's a penalty that could really hurt you. It's now second down and 18.
Now you got to get heat on the quarterback.
They'll hand it off to Veron Haynes. Near side, Haynes close to the 10. He's about 5 yards shy of the first down. Gain of 14, and Haynes is just racking up the yards on the ground.
Well, you should hear the contact on the tail end of this. Listen.
That's why they wear headgear.
That's right. That's why when you're a fullback, you see, they don't run out of bounds when you're a fullback. You put your head down to get an extra yard.
Haynes with 138 yards on the ground. He came in with 170 total. Green goes to the air. Touchdown, Georgia, Terrence Edwards. Terrence Edwards with his fifth touchdown reception of the season and is one shy of the school record held by Bryce Hunter now.
Boy, he just set up Justin Coleman on that fade. He looks back, he just times it, let his route just take him out there exactly where the ball was going to be, just where it's going to be caught perfectly.
18 career touchdowns for Edwards. The record is 19. Georgia's played a lot of football, over 100 years of it. David Green to Terrence Edwards. Dogs lead at 21-9. Back after a word from your local stations. David Green has thrown a couple of interceptions, but he just added a touchdown to his ledger. 14th of the season. Georgia's lead now 21-9. Brett Kerouac kick it away for the Bulldogs. It's a high kick that will fall at the 10. That's where Armstead takes it, and he stopped right there. One of the few times Armstead has been unable to break one. Only a 6-yard return for a man who's been averaging 33 per return. Here's a look at that Georgia scoring drive. 10 plays, 80 yards. That's back-to-back 80-yard drives for the Bulldogs. That one ate up almost 5 minutes. And Georgia now with 21 points. There is another injured Ole Miss receiver. Omar Rayford. That pass is caught by Jamie Armstrong. But losing Omar Rayford, you've lost your tight end, Doug Ziegler.
Exactly.
Dave, what do you, if you're Ole Miss, I mean, where do you go? What do you start to do?
Well, you've got to find a wide receiver. Jamie Armstrong just stepped up on that play. You've got to find some wide receivers to get downfield. Bill Flowers has been real quiet today. We haven't heard much out of him. Chris Collins, those are the guys that got to step up. Armstead perhaps can get out there, but they need to have some of those other players step up. But taking, you take out a Rayford, you take out Ziegler out of your passing game, you're losing a lot. Joe Gunn has been pretty quiet today.
Joe Gunn's been real quiet. Except for that hit. Vieira came flying in there. Gunn loses another five. They've tried that play three or four times today, Dave. Ole Miss has, and it has gone for naught.
Yeah, Vieira's number 15. He's the safety, and he's got that back out of the backfield in the flat there, and he is just flying to the ball. When you're stopping to run up front, the big linemen are, you can take that free safety, and he can run to the football a lot quicker.
Joe Gunn today on the ground, 7 carries, 8 yards. That was a reception. Chris Collins and Flowers have to step up if you're an Ole Miss fan. Pump fake. Flowers comes back to get the pass. He's got 4 Bulldogs putting a helmet on him. At the 22 is where he'll go down.
When you hear the disenchantment here from the fans, that time what they tried to do is they tried to throw deep right there. Deep, and you see Flowers right here down the bottom of the screen. When he gets the football, look at the red hats right next to him, and here comes help.
He lost a couple of yards, Dave. It's now 3rd and 13. Ole Miss going backwards.
Got to find a wideout, got to find him in 12, 15 yard range, pick up a first down.
Georgia coming with some pressure. Ole Miss picks it up, pass is caught. Armstead out over the 40 to the 42. That's a first down for the Rebels, and a big first down, a gain of 17.
Yeah, one-on-one coverage that time. Brandon Williams, the top of the screen. He just curls here, and when he gets the football, too much separation there. He just makes him pay. But good hustle there. You see Briera coming in 15. He's got a lot of people running to the football. But maybe that's something that will break Ole Miss out of this little doldrum that they've been in offensively.
Manning now 23 of 32, but only 127 yards. Pressure avoids it. Pass is caught in Georgia territory once again by Armstead, who's having a career day. Armstead tied a school record held by a couple of guys 2 weeks ago in the Arkansas game when he had 3 touchdown receptions. Dave, here's a look at some Pizza Hut scores, and this is a shocker brewing in Knoxville. 21-7. In Lexington, I need to say. But there will be some shocked people in Knoxville.
They're shocked around the world if that holds up.
Manning. Pass is caught. Not much of a gain. Maybe 2, 2.5. Flowers makes the reception.
But you know what, Dave? All of a sudden, I get the feeling that Eli Manning is starting to get in the groove. He's throwing strikes.
Arkansas leading Mississippi State by a touchdown. Bulldogs kind of just want this year to get over.
Yeah, they do. You're right.
Meanwhile, Arkansas trying to continue with their winning ways. One of the best turnarounds, in-season turnarounds, I have seen in a long, long time from Houston Nuts Bunch. Manning has 7 straight completions. You can make it 8. That's at the 41, about 4, maybe 5 yards shy of the first down. Barkley with the reception, the junior out of New Albany, Mississippi. Just his 3rd catch of the season. Manning starting to spread it out.
Yeah, and he's starting to get hot. He's getting in that little bit of a groove where he starts to move them. They know the time is ticking down. The end of the third quarter is close. They've got to keep on driving. You can't let a team drive back-to-back 80-yard drives and expect to stay in the football game. They've got to respond.
Remember, Manning had completed 18 straight in the opener this year at one point. School record in that department. He's looking for his 9th straight completion, but won't get it as he gets hit as he lets it go. Shedrick Wynn. Backup defensive tackle. Came flying in there to hit Manning.
Wynn did a good move that time. What he did is he ran upfield and he spun back into the quarterback and was right there in his face, disrupting the pass pattern.
Well, Ole Miss will go for it on 4th down. This year on 4th down, Ole Miss highly successful, best in the league. They have converted 10 of 13. Over the middle, passes caught, 1st down, Rebels at the Georgia 30. Wansley was all over him, but Collins made the exceptional catch, a gain of 8.
Boy, and what a catch it was.
That'll be the end of the third quarter. The Rebels are driving, but the Dogs lead it by a dozen. Georgia leads it 21-9 heading into the fourth quarter. Well, get the callers back, and this year is your chance to win every weekend with Ice House. Saturday during the game, a few lucky consumers will get a winning phone call, and one of those winners will get to see their favorite team play all season long, and it could be you. See participating Ice House displays or visit icehouse.com to register your phone number. Ice House, official beer of JP Sports Broadcast, would like to congratulate Stephen Emerson from Bells, Tennessee. Last week's Get the Call grand prize winner. Remember, no purchase necessary. Open to U.S. residents who are 21 or older. See displays for official rules. Sweepstakes ends November 20th, 2001. Well, here we go. Eli Manning in the Ole Miss offense. Red hot. Manning moves out to a wide receiver spot. The snap goes to Armstead, and he loses yardage. Manning was wide open right in front of the Georgia bench.
Nobody covering him. You're exactly right. I don't think he was much of a threat to receive a pass. But David Cutcliffe trying to pull a few tricks. There's Manning out there. Look, I'm going out here. I'm wide open. Throw it to me. Didn't fool Georgia.
Boss Bailey had an eye on him, though. 45 in white. Linebacker. Georgia brings some pressure. That pass is caught, and to Jamie Armstrong, who gets it down to the 27. Terrell Biera on the stop for the Bulldogs. Well, here's a look at stats through three quarters of play, which is brought to you by our good friends at Choice Hotels International. Look at the rushing yards, 180 to 10.
That's the difference in this football game. Ole Miss has never been able to come off the football.
Coming into this game, Ole Miss averaging 150 yards on the ground. They've scored 20 rushing touchdowns, which is first in the league. And they're looking at a third down. They're 7 of 14 on third down conversions today. Manning, it's picked off. Jermaine Phillips has some blockers. Phillips inside the 10. Touchdown. Just the third interception of the year by Eli Manning. And this one gets taken back to the end zone by the senior out of Roswell, Georgia, with his third interception of the season. It was an 82-yard return, and Georgia opening it up on the Rebels. One after. Up and good. 28-9. Folks, hit record on this because this doesn't happen very often to Eli Manning. Jermaine Phillips will certainly remember it. Back after this. A happy Georgia bench after the interception return by Jermaine Phillips. A senior, 6'2", 210 pounds. Georgia now has 9 interceptions as a team as the kickoff sails through the end zone. Let's check in with Scott on the sidelines one more time. And Jermaine Phillips, a guy that finishing up his career at Georgia in big style, isn't he?
Yeah, he certainly is, Dave. A great story of determination. You know, he was a partial qualifier to Georgia. Had to sit out his first year and in order to graduate in 4 years to gain eligibility for a final season. That meant he had to graduate in 4 years. I'll tell you what, he did it early, earned a degree in sports sciences, and actually was named to the Dean's List twice. Now he's ranked the top senior free safety by some NFL scouts. I'd say he's putting that sports sciences degree to use, too, after that pick, taking it to the house.
Absolutely, Scott, the former wide receiver. Played offense, defense, special teams during his career, and one of those guys coaches love to have. Pass is complete, picks up about 6 on the play by to Jamie Armstrong. But Phillips, Dave, is one of those just big hitters.
Oh, yeah.
He can turn a game around. There are few guys could do this, but he's one of those guys that can turn a game around with a big hit.
Exactly right. Turned around with a big interception right there, because that was huge. If Ole Miss had gone down there and scored, they'd have been right back in this football game. But instead, he just turned, took the tide. But, you know, I got to give a little bit of credit. David Pollock had a great pass rush that time. That's what really started the rush on Manning and didn't allow him to find his wide receiver.
Great tackle in the secondary by Kentrell Curry. And Ole Miss loses a couple. And Armstrong now slow to get up. Remember, they're out without Rayford, they're without Ziegler, the tight end. Collins has a bad ankle. And now it looks as though Armstrong might be hobbling a little bit as well.
We did get up limping over to the sideline. They're going to run out of wide receivers here soon.
We're going to send our spotter Kim Anderson down there. Oh, no.
But they're not that bad.
Manning steps up. Looking, dumps it off, tried to find Joe Gunn. He had Chris Collins way downfield. But it looked as though he didn't have it. The way he was running, he couldn't have really thrown it. Collins was about 50 yards downfield, and I don't think Manning could have gotten the football to him.
No, exactly right. As he was coming out there, he was working on the corner, trying to make the corner come up. But you're right, he had Collins down here. Look at Collins way downfield. Now right there, Collins loses him. Look at Collins now, just throw it. And he sees Manning go down. But three and out again, that's been the nemesis of Ole Miss today. But the injuries just keep on mounting up. You just can't lose that many guys and expect to be competitive in this league.
Ridgeway's punt. Fair catch at the 38. Georgia Bulldogs lead a hobbling Ole Miss Rebel team 28-9. Back after this.
Down. So you like scoring? We've got scoring. Unfortunately for Ole Miss, it's mostly on the Georgia side.
3 second half touchdowns for the Bulldogs. Look at the 51 yards of offense in the second half by the Rebels. And Georgia's running game has been the difference in the second half. Eli Manning, frustrating afternoon for Eli. Eli today, 30 of 42, 164 yards. As Archie has watched his son throw one touchdown and one interception, it is a rarity. I mean, I wasn't kidding when I said record the interception, because it's not going to happen.
Oh, you're absolutely right. What's interesting is to see what a quarterback does when he's not having a good game. I talked earlier about him sputtering in the first half, and he wasn't throwing. All of a sudden, he got on a little streak there and seemed like he was coming out of it. Then he throws the interception. He gets hurried. So you want to see what your quarterback can do when he's not having a good day.
Armstrong getting his ankle taped. David, I got to wonder, it's been a couple of weeks since the Arkansas game, but that's a football game that has got to stick with you. And I'm wondering if there's not that hangover from that particular game when so much was taken out of the Ole Miss sails.
Yeah, I think you're right. Mentally, it was really, really depressing for them, because they thought they could win, and they thought they were going to win, and they stayed in it for so long, and then all of a sudden you come home, then you have an extra week.
Big third down. The Rebels can get back in it in a hurry. Here's Haynes. Has some room on the outside. Veron Haynes. First down, Georgia at the Rebel 43-yard line. Veron Haynes picks up 16. And he now has 161 yards on the ground.
You talk about following your fullback. JT Walls, the fullback. Look at him just staying on his hip. Walls out in front of he gets the block. He just keeps on running right off his tail. Boy, man, you talk about setting up your blockers. And how about Haynes? I mean, we're talking about a guy, he wasn't a star when he came in here, but he's been a star today.
Dave, he came into this game, 37 carries, 170 yards on the ground. Today, he's gone for 161 and half the carries. Here's Jasper Sanks. It was such a topic of discussion in our meetings with the Georgia coaches this week about running the football. They didn't know what they were going to do. They got to find somebody out of their pool of running backs, and it was an issue in the Atlanta papers about how come Georgia can't run the football. Well, they They've answered a lot of questions today.
Well, and to tell you how desperate where they were, they take two fullbacks. JT Wall is a fullback, as is Verron Haynes. And they run two fullbacks out there. One plays tailback, one plays fullback. So they have to change assignments. But it's worked very, very well for them. I think JT Wall has had just an exceptional day.
Sanks. He's close to a first down. Markers at the 33-yard line, just inside the 33, and they'll mark it at the 34, so about a yard shy.
Boy, this is where those big offensive linemen, they just love it. Opening up holes, everybody's ripping up through for big yards, tearing them down. If you're on the defensive side of the ball, it's a long afternoon. They got their hands on their hips, they're tired on defense. Offense, they're ready, they're pumped up, ready to go.
Eight to nine, we move under 9 minutes. First down, Georgia at the 30. Georgia now with 210 yards of rushing offense today. JT Wall, the fullback, spinning.
And you know, you talked about the day that Verron Haynes has had. JT Wall, he only came in here with four carries leading into this game.
Lucius Smith out with an injury. Verron Haynes, 161. Sanks with 50. JT Wall, throw him in that mix. He's got six carries for 15 yards. Remember this, though, about that defensive front from Ole Miss. They're missing Johnson, who got hurt earlier this year. Junior out of Atlanta, backup tackle. Kenny Jackson's out with an injury. Josh Cooper has been suspended for a game. Haynes, look at him, bounce off defenders, touchdown. Georgia travels 26 yards, and what an afternoon for the man who grew up in New York City.
Demoralizing up front. And look at this hole up in there. Great position right there. Drive him past Von Hutchins. He's just a bounce off. And Haynes goes in with just a romp into the end zone. And he's more than double. He's doubled his yards today, hasn't he? Wow.
Verron Haynes has brought his New York state of mind to Oxford, Mississippi. And it's worked quite well. Georgia opening up big time. 35-9, Georgia puts up their fifth touchdown behind Verron Haynes.
Boy, great up front block there. He saw that one by JT Wall, and then stiff arm, just push Von Hutchins off, bump into the end zone. Wow, making it look easy.
Collins takes a knee. Georgia, 230 yards on the ground. Ole Miss rushing today, 10 yards.
And you know what, I can't remember where they got that 10 yards. I hate to tell you that. It has not come easy.
Verron Haynes, what a great guy he is to talk to. We spent some time with him earlier this year. I mentioned it earlier, and it just sticks out in my mind. You know, there's a guy that's got so much going on, and he organizes guys. He goes around and gets some football players every week to make a trip to a local children's hospital. He just does it on his own. Just one of the things he does.
Yeah, that's just a wonderful story. Of course, you lose the Musa Smith, and all of a sudden you lose what you think is your offense, and someone like him steps up and just takes over.
Let's check in with Scott down on the sideline. Scott.
Yeah, Dave, I'll tell you, the Georgia coaches couldn't be happier with that offensive line for Georgia. Why? Sustained drives. They came into this game as the only team in the SEC not to score a touchdown on a drive of 5 minutes or longer. They've been close to 5 minutes a couple times today, running the football and really putting a hurting on that Ole Miss defense.
That's what they wanted to do, and they coaches challenged Neil Callaway, the offensive coordinator, offensive line coach for Georgia, challenged his guys.
Well, what they did, Dave, is they came out at the beginning of that second half. You remember David Green had that bad first half, two interceptions. They weren't doing anything, and they literally ran it down their throat. They ran 9 or 10 straight runs and scored on an 80-yard drive, and then put another one back-to-back.
Take a look at second half rushing.
Wow.
Well, in fairness to Ole Miss, they got out of their offensive flow. They've fallen behind. Now it's just throw the football. Joe Gunn has been quiet. We talked about that all day.
That pass is caught. Rick Rosano, fullback. Time to update you on what's happening on our Pizza Hut scoreboard and a big one in Lexington. Kentucky responds. Tennessee tied it up at 21. They were down 21-7. They tie it up at 21, and Kentucky has just responded. South Carolina, all their injuries and everything, and they're still putting it on Clemson. Illinois over Ohio State. Arkansas and Mississippi State tied at halftime. Joe Gunn tries to turn the corner and does. Joe Gunn, flags are everywhere. Maybe there's a reason he got the corner.
Yeah, that's exactly why he got the corner. Hold out there on the wide receiver. You can see the disgust on Joe Gunn's face. They walk back. Man, Georgia has just dismantled them. They got into a flow, and when the Ole Miss got their opportunities, they didn't score. You see the holding signal against Ole Miss, and David Cutcliffe just shakes his head.
Here comes Rogers Redding.
We have holding against the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replay first down.
Well, a lot of Georgia fans made it here to Atlanta. And surprised many of them actually got here after what happened at the Atlanta airport, where they shut it down for a few hours yesterday and put 10,000 people out in the street. But they finally got here, and believe it or not, one guy, Georgia fan, caused all the havoc. I mean, it's a trying time right now in air travel. But Michael Lassiter out of Gainesville, Georgia, is allegedly the man who broke through security and caused the shutdown of the airport and caused many people a lot of headaches at the airport. But he was on his way to this football game.
That's right. Hey, you do anything you can to get to the game. Well, we've got a lot of Georgia fans that have really enjoyed it today. I know the Nelson family there, they've really enjoyed it. And I got a friend of mine, Henry Barrow, and I know he's just licking his chops today. So they're having a wonderful day.
Our spotter, Kim Anderson, was actually on the flight that Mr. Lassiter was supposed to be on, and Kim was on standby and probably got Lassiter's seat because Lassiter didn't make the flight.
He forgot his camera bag.
Had to go back and get the camera bag. You'll do that's the more I hear about this story, the crazier it is.
You know,
that'll be a first down for Ole Miss.
And you mentioned Kim Anderson. He says to me, he says, you got to mention my friends, David and Kendall Nelson. I did mention them. I said the Nelsons. Now he's making me first names. This guy's taking over the broadcast.
First down, Ole Miss.
Lassiter, kind of just to finish up that story on the Georgia fan trying to get here, because I think it's crazy. He actually went back to go get a camera they left at the counter.
Uh-huh.
And saw the line to get through security and went down by baggage claim and ran down the escalator. Pass is caught inside the 20.
Yeah, but you remember he ran down the up escalator, dude.
Bo Hartsfield, the tight end, getting some action because Ziegler is out with a broken arm.
Nice pass, good pattern right here. Get downfield, get open. And we talked about what Ziegler took out of their offense when they lost him, and you see him there. That is a real hurt because Ziegler is a good downfield receiver. So Hartsfield has to step up.
That's a big, big blow to their offense. The tight end is a big factor in their game plan. And Ziegler, of course, Eli's roommate as well. Hurt. Manning goes to the air and tries to find another man who can catch it, and it's Jamie Armstrong with his first touchdown reception of the season.
Boy, now's the time when you start talking what ifs. What if Eli Manning hadn't thrown that interception that was returned? But look at this pass. Well thrown, on the run, lays it up, just a perfectly thrown ball. Can't do it any better than that.
Oh, he missed it. Oh, wow.
The instant replay of the Jumbotron is brought to you by TouchMart.
It doesn't go your way. It doesn't go your way.
You're absolutely right, partner.
Lee Rogers misses the point after. But let's go back to the touchdown.
Well, I thought he almost dropped that. Look at that. That ball was centered to him off center, and he just reached out with that left hand and caught it.
That was a beautiful pass.
Yes. Oh, it was a perfect pass, but how about the catch coming off the ball? But look at that, just lays that right in there. Beautifully thrown.
Well, for Manning, he now has 25 touchdown passes, 3 interceptions. Eli is a guy that frustrated by this afternoon. 47 pass attempts today is a career high for him. He's thrown for 233 yards. He's already set 4 Ole Miss season or career records. It's 25 touchdowns, also a school record for a season. He's first nationally in touchdown interception ratio, 7th nationally in completions per game, 7th in touchdown passes overall. And I'm sure Archie and Eli will break down this game, much like Archie's doing right now, to those who will listen.
Yeah. And you notice that Olivia sitting next to him, she's not listening. She's talking to anybody will listen to him. Well, that fellow doesn't want to listen either. It's not going Ole Miss's way today. Archie says, I'm going to go upstairs and find somebody that I can tell this to.
Yeah, I'm going to go somebody else who will listen. I got some explaining to do. Here's Gibson at the 7. Gibson. Fred Gibson to the 30. Gibson has been real quiet today. Gibson won't pick up 100 yards receiving today for the first time in 5 games. Don't forget, in 2 weeks, that's December 1st, we will wrap up our JP football season. We'll head back here and check out the Ole Miss Rebels and the Vanderbilt Commodores. Woody Woodhoffer's final game at the helm of the Commodore program. He'll take on David Cutcliffe and Eli Manning. Maybe, I think Archie went to the phone outside and calling Eli up. Yeah. Eli, being the son, has to listen.
Oh, gee.
Ron Haynes out over the 35, 4:17 and ticking.
Dave, you know, we talked a lot about the defense of Georgia responding and shutting down this Ole Miss team. You know, whenever you get a player like someone like a David Jacobs who gets hurt, and your players rally around him, and a lot of them step up, and it becomes like a purpose to play. And you've got to credit these Georgia players. Their emotions have really been torn this week with losing David Jacobs.
Yeah, Jacobs was a guy that was kind of a leader on that defensive line, and this team has put them in their thoughts and prayers heading into this football game. Of course, just to those of you joining us, Jacobs, a man that neurologically had some issues this week. Georgia doctors, medical staff, not sure exactly what is occurring with him, so they sent him to Emory, one of the best hospitals in the entire world in Atlanta, and they're running tests on him, and it could be 2, 3, 4 days before he gets out of the hospital. They're not real sure about what is happening. So scary situation, but Mr. Jacobs in very good hands in Atlanta right now. Now it's time to look at the BMW Ultimate Drive of the Game, which is brought to you by BMW, the ultimate driving machine. Terrence Edwards on the receiving end of one of the few passes David Green has thrown in the second half. It capped off a 10-play, 80-yard drive, and it was a 10-yard touchdown reception, a drive that almost lasted 5 minutes, something Georgia hasn't seen a lot of, and that is lengthy drives this year. Georgia leads it by 20.
And it has just been that controlling offensive line up front, blowing them off the ball, hard running up in there. Had a fullback that responded, JT Wall, Haynes, and Jasper Sanks has had good yards today.
Sanks has 50 yards on 9 carries and a touchdown today.
you're on the Ole Miss side, you just say, hey, this is one of those games where it just didn't go our way. They were unable to start anything on offense, couldn't get their running game going. Joe Gunn was quiet. Then they lose Ziegler, they lose Rayford. They've had nicks and bumps all over the place. You just can't take that on a team that relies so much on the passing game.
First down, Georgia. That goes to Braxton Snyder, the fullback. Backup fullback getting a lot of work. Braxton, a senior out of Lexington, Kentucky. Some playing time. You'll remember that carry for a long, long time. How about Jasper Sanks? It has been a tumultuous career for that man, but feeling pretty good about things today.
Yeah, and a lot of Georgia fans made their trek over here.
Dave, I think the Georgia defense set the tone for this whole game.
I do too. When we were down there and we were talking to their staff, and Brian Van Gorder turned around and said, we couldn't lose David Jacobs. Somebody's got to step up. Well, let me tell you something. This defense stepped up. You talk about shutting down the running game. The running game is non-existent.
Update on our Pizza Hut scoreboard. Kentucky holding on by a touchdown, 28-21. South Carolina holding on to their advantage over Clemson. Busy day, Jefferson Pilot Sports. Charles Davis is in Lexington with the Volunteers and Wildcats. Will rejoin us for the season finale. 30 seconds left in this game. So the Georgia Bulldogs will win it by 20 in an awesome display by Veron Haynes. Haynes had a career day. 26 carries, 192 yards, and 2 touchdowns. And Georgia will win their 5th in a row over the Ole Miss Rebels. Up next for the Bulldogs, a date with Georgia Tech next Saturday. Up next for the Rebels, a date with Mississippi State in just 4 days. Mark Richt, a happy coach, as the Dogs win for the 6th time this year. We'll come back to Oxford, put a wrap on it right after this. Stay with us.